Hello. How are we doing? My name is Josh Noblet. I'm one of the pastors at the church. And I am not going to be with you this morning, obviously, as I'm on the video. But can we all give it up for Tim Weber, Bishop, Reverend, I don't know of any other names. But he's going to be preaching this morning, and I am excited about it. In fact, I'm kind of bummed about it because I'm not going to be there, but it's going to be amazing. And speaking of amazing, I am also very excited about Passion Camp. I am about to hop on a bus, which is right out there, with 30 of our upperclassmen, some graduated seniors, some students going into junior and senior year. And we're going to go to Passion Camp at Daytona Beach. And as I wrestle and as I think about and as I pray about what's going to take place and what I would long for God to do down at a camp like this, I just get excited because I think the possibilities are endless as we sing to Him, as we dive into His Word together, as we get in conversations around Him and what He has to say about our lives and about who He is. I believe that God moves in us and for us and around us when we move towards Him. When we draw near to God, He draws near to us. And so if I'm excited about it for Passion Camp, I better be excited about it for Oak Ridge City. You have the opportunity to draw near to God. And when you move towards Him, He moves in our lives. He does. And speaking of the opportunity to talk to God, to think about God, to meet with God, to move towards God, there's a new dynamic in my life when it comes to these trips. I'm so excited, but now I'm a father, and I have two children, and I don't get to hear their voices for the next 5 days, and so I always also get a little bit sad that I'm not going to hear from them. And some of you are like, what about your wife? Don't get me wrong. I will be very excited to get home and see my wife, but it's the 21st century. Okay, we have FaceTime, we'll talk a lot, okay? But I won't FaceTime my daughters, and so I won't hear their voices at all. And so I'm already excited to get back on Friday and hear little Josie say, Daddy, Daddy! And I'm excited to hear Georgia say, Daddy, I'm excited about that. And if I, an imperfect father, long to hear from my kids and long to have my kids move towards me, how much more does your Heavenly Father long to hear from you today? I want you to know He does. He loves you. He delights in you singing to Him. He delights in you opening up your heart to Him and praying to Him and talking to Him and moving towards Him. So lean in today. Lean in today. And guess what? If my daughters have a bad week, if they take bad naps, and if they give their mom a bunch of trouble, and if they're mean to one another, I'm not going to get home and say, wait another week until you get your stuff together before you can come and talk to me. No, no matter what you come into church today with, if you feel some shame, if there's some sin, if there's some darkness, if you have been given the right to become a child of God through faith in Jesus, God is pleased with you today, and He longs for you to worship Him, to meet with Him, to come to His altar today. And so together, let's do that. Why don't you stand up, say hello to someone around you, and we're going to go to God in worship.
Overwhelmed by the weight of sin, Jesus. Yeah. nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. So come on my soul, oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. You've got a lion inside those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So come on my soul, oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. You've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So come on my soul, oh don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul. You got a lion inside of those stones. Get up and praise the Lord.
You guys can go and take a seat. We're going to take communion here in just a moment. It is awesome to worship. What amazing songs. Just to be reminded of just the greatness and the goodness of our God, and that really our only response is praise and thanksgiving. So we're going to remember now exactly what Jesus did for us 2,000 years ago. And if you're a believer in Christ, we invite you to participate with us. If you're not sure about this whole thing, Jesus thing, we just maybe take some time and just meditate and think and maybe explore a little bit of who Christ is as we talk this morning and hear the message of Christ. But a couple months ago, I went to Israel with Josh and the Webbers here. Tim's going to be speaking today. And we had a great trip and went to see many, many places. And it was kind of overwhelming. And there was really, for me, only a couple times during the trip where you actually got some time to absorb it, a couple emotional moments. And one, we took a boat ride on the Sea of Galilee, and it was pretty cool to just think that Jesus had walked on that water and all the ministry that he did there. And we were singing worship songs, and that was an emotional, really connecting experience for me. And I guess another time was we were at a place called the Garden Tomb. And they're not sure, but they gave some compelling evidence that it might have been the place where Jesus was crucified and then actually where he was laid in a nearby tomb. And we were able at this place to take communion together. And Josh actually led us. We had a group of like 12, but was mixed in with a group of 42. And it was a great time just to remember But for me, I guess what Israel and specifically this time at the Garden Tomb was all about was that, you know, these things actually took place. Like, we walked around, we took car rides, we took bus rides to actual places that we read about in the scriptures where they weren't just giving compelling evidence. They were positive that some of the events took place at the places that we were at. So as we take communion, I think sometimes it's easy to almost be detached and not to really think about the fact that a man who was God in the flesh, actually took our punishment, actually went through torture and agony, all because of love. And maybe it's easy, not easy, but we can relate a little bit to the physical pain that he went through, imagining how horrible that had to be. But we can never, ever understand the fact that he who knew no sin became sin on our behalf, and that the perfect one was stained while he was on that cross with our sin, with our grotesque rebellion. And we'll never understand that. And I think what's appropriate is for us to do basically what we just sang about, and just to throw up our hands and give thanks and praise to a God who loves us. So we want you to take just a few moments, just to reflect on that. That Jesus, while grace is free, cost our God so much. Take some time, reflect, and prepare the elements, and then I'll lead us in just a moment. If you all would, you can go ahead and take the bread and go ahead and eat, and remember that this was the body of Christ given up for us. And then we are told in this time of remembrance to drink from the cup and remember that it's the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the blood of the new covenant. Father in heaven, we throw up our hands and we say thank you, and we proclaim the death of Jesus Christ when we remember through these emblems as we take communion, Father. We proclaim that it is finished, that your plan of salvation is complete because of the work of Jesus Christ. We proclaim the fact that Jesus is not dead, that we have a God who cares, that he rose to life and he is active in our lives right now, and he is preparing a place. And one day our ultimate hope is that Jesus will come back, and like he was resurrected, we will be as well. And this place will be made perfect, and our bodies will be made perfect, and we will be high-fiving and saying, can you believe it's better than we even imagined? Thank you, God, for your love for us. Thank you for the amazing sacrifice. Help us to never forget and to throw up our hands in prayer and thanksgiving to you all the time. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand up and sing again.
Thank you so much that we're all able to gather in this place today to worship you. I pray that as we go about our week, I pray that we would eagerly pour out to other people. I pray that we would have you in mind every moment of our day. I pray that we would praise your name boldly, that we would not be ashamed of the gospel. I pray that you would refine us day by day, moment by moment. I pray that you would help us to understand your word and your teachings. We love you so much. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Well, good morning, Oak Ridge City. It's good to be with you this morning. This is my third time to be here, and just something special about what God's doing in this place and with his people. Just exciting to be here and to share what God's put on my heart. I do have to warn you, I'm going to be skating on some pretty thin ice during this message. I'm going to be talking about your pets. So I want to just see how many folks I'm going to offend right off the bat here. So if you consider yourself a dog person, would you let me know? All right. How about a cat person? A few people. All right. Be brave. It's okay. All right. We have a dog, and her name is Kirby. And Kirby is a year and a half old Wheaton Terrier. And we love Kirby. That's our dog. She's a good girl. She's a little bit crazy, as all terriers are. Her favorite food is butter from the dining room table. So if she could have that, she's a happy girl. But Kirby is pretty simple. When I come home or my wife, she wags her little tail and is so excited. And it's just, just pure, kind of her love. So dogs are pretty simple. So I came across a diary of a dog that I thought I would share and see if this fits the dogs that you know. 8 a.m., oh boy, dog food, my favorite. 10 a.m., oh boy, a car ride, my favorite. Noon, oh boy, a walk, my favorite. The yard, my favorite. The kids, my favorite. Mom, my favorite. Sleeping in my master's bed, my favorite. Pretty simple, right? Came across a diary of a cat. Reads a little bit differently. Day 183 of my captivity. The captors continue to taunt me with bizarre little dangling objects. They dine lavishly on fresh meat while I am forced to eat dry cereal. The only thing that keeps me going is the hope of escape and the mild satisfaction I get from ruining the occasional piece of furniture. Tomorrow, I may eat another houseplant. Today, my attempt to kill my captors by weaving around their feet while they were walking almost succeeded. Must try this at the top of the stairs. I am convinced the other captives are snitches. The dog is routinely released and seems more than happy to return. He is obviously a little bit slow in the head. The bird, on the other hand, has got to be an informant and speaks with his boss regularly. I am certain he reports my every move. Due to his current placement in the metal room, his safety is assured, but I can wait. It's only a matter of time. Now, you have to admit, you cat people, there's some truth there, isn't there? Right? I mean, I stepped on your toes just a little bit, but we could understand what's going on. So there's an old saying about cats and dogs that I think illustrates them pretty well. You say to a dog, you love me, you pet me, you take care of me, you are kind to me, you must be God, the dog says. But a cat, you say to a cat, you love me, you take care of me, you pet me, you're kind to me, cat thinks that they're God. So it's a question of who's here for who, right? So this is illustrated all over, but I found an old poster of Garfield, where on Garfield, it's the old movie, it says it's all about meow. It's all about meow. So cats are kind of known to be pretty in tune with themselves. And they kind of have their own little world, and we're just fortunate to be living in it. So that's a little bit about cats and dogs. I think this kind of gets to the core of a cat, but you may see that differently. There's a challenge in our culture and how we relate to God. The word we use for our understanding of God is called theology. And we all have theology. It's not a question of whether you have a theology, you have a view of God. The question is whether that theology is aligned to Scripture, is biblical, is true, is right. So we all have a theology. So there's a tendency in our culture to kind of differentiate this idea of a cat and dog, but when it comes to theology, we do something similar. So we might call it dog theology and cat theology. You see, dog theology says, Lord, you love me, you blessed me abundantly, you gave your life for me, you must be God. Where cat theology says, Lord, you love me, you blessed me abundantly, you gave your life for me, I must be God. It's a question of who is here for who. Is God here to benefit our desires, our wants, and our whenever we kind of want something new? Is God the one that we go to kind of ask for that? Or at the core, are we here for God? You see, the message we hear loudly in our culture is that life is about us. Life is about kind of satisfying our own needs. There's a saying that says we get all we can all we get, and then we sit on the can. So it's about consumption. And I fall into that trap just as much as everybody else. But we live in a world that kind of feeds that, and with advertising and all kinds of things. There was an old ad for Burger King that was, the headline was, Have It Your Way. And when it comes to God, that's kind of our approach. We ask for better health or for a better job or for a better family. And we kind of elevate our desires and kind of try to manipulate what he is doing for us rather than submitting our needs to the king. So we ask God to bless us when we should be asking, what does God want from us? It's easy to be a cat. You see, cats never directly say, I must be God, but we elevate what we want at the expense of who God is and what he wants for us. God exists to meet our needs, and instead of praying, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done," we reverse that, and we want our kingdom to be on earth. So there's a quote by James Mulholland that says, "In December, I addressed my request to Santa Claus. The rest of the year, I petitioned God. My real concern is how to get God to give me what I want. My desire is to manipulate God rather than to know him. Prayer is about me. Bless me, protect me, take care of me." That's the heart of a cat. That's the heart of one that doesn't submit to what God asks of us. You see, before 1543, we earthlings enjoyed center stage. A father could walk out with his child and point to the stars and say, "The universe revolves around us." But then came Nicholas Copernicus, and Copernicus began asking questions like, "Why do the waves come in? How far can a ship sail before it falls off the end of the earth? Why do some stars appear during the day and others at night?" When like-minded Galileo came along, the throne locked him up. And it was revolutionary to kind of think the earth is not the center of the universe, that we revolve around the sun. You see, for believers, for Christians, we have that same principle. We are not the center. We revolve around the sun, God's sun. And God, in his sovereignty, taps on the collective shoulder of humanity, points to his son, and says, "That's the center. That's the core. That's what you should be revolving around." We orient our life around Jesus. He doesn't orient his life around our every want and need. There's verses that testify to this, and there's many. Let me throw out a few. In Colossians 1, it says, "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him." What we see has been created for God's glory. He's allowed us to partake in that, but he's at the center of it. Psalm 115 says, "Our God is in heaven. He does whatever pleases him." Again, Psalm 145, "Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom." You see, again, using the sun is at the middle, and it gives the light. The moon reflects the light. She generates no light. The moon has no power of its own. But apart from the sun, the moon is nothing more than a dark rock. But properly positioned, the moon glows. The moon reflects that light, and it becomes a source of beauty, a source of even romance. We see the sun shining on the moon, reflecting the light. That is the role of a believer, to reflect the light of Jesus Christ. When he shines on us, he changes us. He changes our desires, our heart, our wants, and we begin to look more like him. But it's only when we receive that reflection, when we allow Christ to kind of invade our heart. So there's lots of examples of this idea in Scripture. And we see this all throughout the Old and the New Testament, of men and women that allowed their lives to be changed by Jesus Christ and by the gospel. So the person we're going to focus on for the rest of our time is someone who kind of stood at a pivotal place in Scripture. That's John the Baptist. So John the Baptist showed up on the planet about 400 years after the end of the Old Testament. So we see him at the very beginning of the New Testament. We read this in the book of Mark. It describes a little bit about who John the Baptist was. Mark 1, 1 through 8 says, "The beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, 'I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him.' And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Israel went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel hair and a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message: after me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist was one of the more unique characters in Scripture. When I was born, I was named Timothy after the Timothy in the Bible, and my sisters, Sarah, Elizabeth, Hannah, and Rebecca, all had names after ladies in the Bible. You hear a lot of Johns, but not many named after John the Baptist. So John the Baptist was unique. Locusts, wild honey. His life ends in cut short, and we'll see that part of the story in just a little bit. But John was unique. John and Jesus were relatives. John's mom was Elizabeth, and Jesus' mom were Mary, and they were related. So John the Baptist was born, and Jesus was born 6 months later. So most likely they were at family functions and grew up somewhat in close proximity with each other. So the John that we read of in Scripture, the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and the John that wrote the book of Revelation is a different John. But John the Baptist shows up multiple places in the Gospels and has a pretty unique life, pretty unique story. John's message from the beginning was repent. Repent just means to turn around. You're going one direction, repent, turn around, and go another direction. John spoke boldly and with clarity. I kind of picture John like the 350-pound offensive lineman, clearing the path for Jesus to carry the ball through the line into the end zone. John prepared the way for Jesus. So spoke on repentance, cleared the way for Jesus, and appeared just at the fullness of time. I mentioned 400 years. So last book of the Old Testament was Malachi. And then we have the Gospels beginning. So during that time, it was a period of silence. There wasn't any record that we have in Scripture. Now, we have historical record of what was going on then. But the prophets stopped speaking with Malachi all the way to the beginning of the New Testament. So the Jewish people were hungry for God's word. They're hungry for what God was wanting to tell them. And John the Baptist appeared on the scene and spoke with authority from God. So John was actually considered a prophet that prepared the way for Jesus. John's uncompromising nature got him in trouble. So Rome had appointed a ruler of that area named Herod Antipas. And Herod Antipas was not a good dude. And he caused a lot of trouble for the Jewish people during that time. And so not only did he cause a lot of trouble, but his personal life was a mess. And so he married his brother's wife. His brother's wife was Herodias. And John called him out on that. And Herodias didn't like it. And so she had John imprisoned. And as he was imprisoned, eventually John was beheaded. And so that's how John's life ends. At the beginning, it's foretold that John would clear the way for the Messiah. At the end, he ends up beheaded because of the whim of a spoiled lady. So that's the summary of John the Baptist. John the Baptist came in, cleared the way for Jesus, and we're going to see a few things that he said that I believe get to the heart of this idea of what it means to put God first. And John understood his role. And I think there's something for all of us as we kind of go through this to understand what God might be calling for each of us. So I want to give you three qualities of John's life that informed his view of God. Three qualities that spoke to how he understood what God, who God was and what God wanted from him. Two of these are things that John says about himself, and one will be something that Jesus says about John. So I think the first thing that's important to understand from John's life is that he had an elevated view of God, and that was demonstrated in upward thinking. So in John 3:31, we read, "The one who comes from heaven, comes from above, is above all. And the one who is from earth belongs to the earth and speaks as one from the earth. The one who comes from heaven is above all." So he uses this "above all" twice. What he's doing is contrasting who he is with who Jesus is. And he's saying that Jesus is above all. He's at the top. I'm kind of the king of to-dos. If you look at the app that I use, I have about 35 to-dos on my list as of this morning. I checked before the service. And I'm good about throwing them in. What I struggle with sometimes is knowing which one is above all, what the priority is, right? So we all could do that. We all have tasks, things that were asked of us that kind of start building up. But what's the most important? Well, John is kind of setting that stage. He's demonstrating this upward thinking where he says that God is ultimate and that man is not. You see, theology means the study of God, as we said, and we all have it, the question of whether our theology is accurate or inaccurate. So when it comes to our theology, our thinking of God, some of us have kind of twisted who God is. And our understanding and our perception of what God is like is not what the Bible really says. It's not what the Bible talks about. So I've seen this demonstrated in a few ways, but I think we kind of can look at God maybe like bubble wrap. So bubble wrap, my wife and I, when we were first dating, my nickname for her was bubble wrap because she's very cautious. And some of you might fall into that as well. And being cautious is good. I, as somebody who's not nearly as cautious, I need that balance, right? We all need that. But when it comes to our understanding of God, that could be kind of how we see God, that God is just there to keep the bad things from happening. Anybody struggle with that? That maybe that's how we understand who God is? So when bad things start to happen, it maybe makes us doubt who God is or what God is really like. We see bad things happen a lot, and we're not going to kind of go through all the ones that we see in Scripture, but even with John the Baptist, we see that his life ended when he was beheaded. So John was on the scene and was obedient and did a lot of things right, but his life was cut short with what we would consider tragedy. So we see this in a lot of the prophets. Being a prophet was not easy. A prophet spoke on God's behalf, and many times that wasn't received well. And so prophets, oftentimes, their lives were cut short. So we kind of have this idea in our culture that if we follow God, if we're obedient, if we do everything right, that God's going to take care of every one of our needs. And he's going to kind of provide and keep us safe. And we see that life doesn't work like that. God is a good God. And he takes care of us. He does. But oftentimes, it's not like we would expect. We also maybe view God as Santa Claus. And We go to Santa Claus and we want stuff, and so we go to God and we want stuff. But what happens when God gives us the stuff that we want? So sometimes he does, it feels like, and sometimes he doesn't. But if we were to ask for the stuff we want, we might get in trouble. I remember when I was 16, the car I wanted more than any other was a Pontiac Fiero. Anybody remember the Pontiac Fiero? I just saw that the Pontiac Fiero was the most dangerous car ever made. So 260 times the engine exploded that they have record of. But in my 16-year-old mind, that's what I wanted to be happy, right? So we approach God like we do Santa Claus. 70% of all lottery winners end up bankrupt. What happens when we get what we want? Oftentimes, it doesn't go well, but we kind of judge God based on that. God doesn't work like that. Or butterflies. We associate God with butterflies. When the feelings are there, God's presence must be real. And when the feelings aren't, God is distant and he's not with me. So we know this is not true, but even Jesus, when he was in the garden before he went to the cross, he prayed, "God, if it's your will, take this cup from me, but not I will as you." So in that moment, I guarantee the butterflies were not there. Jesus was not feeling it. But he was obedient to what God had called him to do. You see, something interesting happens. The more we follow God, the more that we're obedient, the more he begins to change our desires. Psalm 37:4 says, "Delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." It doesn't mean he's going to give you everything that you want. It means that he will change your desires to look more like his. But in order for that to happen, we must delight in him. The last kind of misconception we have of God is this picture. I don't know if we have it up there. Anybody know who that is? Miss Trunchbull, I think is how you say that, from Matilda. So we've all had that teacher, maybe, that just kind of was the judgmental, ornery teacher. And every opportunity that she had kind of maybe put us down or made life difficult. And so some of us associate God with that, perhaps. That God is just wanting to kind of judge us and give us guilt. And we don't ever experience or we don't know about the freedom that comes by following God's principles. Let me just say that if you follow who God is, if you really understand what he's like, there is tremendous freedom there. There's tremendous freedom to be the man or the woman that God has created you to be. But in order for that to happen, we submit to him, and then he changes our desires. You see, we understand who God is a number of different ways, but one of the big ones is by reading the book of Psalms. So if you're not familiar with Psalms, if you open the middle of your Bible, it's right there. But Psalms gives us an understanding, gives us a picture of what God's really like, of who God is. We see God's character in there. So when John makes a statement, "The one who comes from above is above all," we see that supremacy and the priority of who God is. We can read this in Psalm 145. It says, "I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works for another. They tell of your mighty acts." That one generation, that's so important for us to understand. And this church, I believe, does a great job of that. But we lose it when we don't communicate God's great works to the next generation. We miss an opportunity. God has called us to not only experience him, but to pass that on to the next generation. Then he goes on, "They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made." You see, God is good. God is good. And when we come to God with these broken perceptions of what he's like, we don't experience that goodness like he would have us experience. Christians, we are called to trust him, and as we trust him, we understand his goodness. So first thing we need to do is to have upward thinking if we're going to kind of understand who God is. Second thing is we need to have downward living. We see this in a couple places in John. So John 3:30 says, "He must become greater, I must become less." And again in Mark 1, we see, "And this was his message, after me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Untying sandals was the job reserved for the lowest servant. John's saying, in contrasting with Jesus, "I'm not even worthy to untie his sandals." You see, when John was on the earth and he was baptizing people, he had a huge following. And he could have easily taken that momentum, taken the fame that he had, and used that for his glory. But John redirected that to Christ. In your position, in your world that you live, it's easy to take credit for things that we should be directing to Jesus. You see this in John. He redirected the message to Christ. So I was a part of the group that went to Israel, as Herc said. And he mentioned the garden too. So I actually have a picture of that, I think. So the Golgotha, the place of the skull, is right next to that. This is the entrance where it's possible where Jesus spent a couple nights buried. So when you go in there, you don't walk in. Even somebody like me who's 5'6", you have to bend down. That door is 5 foot tall. It was made that way so that when you walk in, you bent down as a sign of reverence. Tombs in that area had a similar height. Even kings during that, before that time and during that time, it was thought many had rooms where they would meet with people where the doors were low. So as you went in to meet, you had to bow down. So this idea of reverence, this idea of bowing down and recognizing who we are and who Jesus is so important for the believer. Be humble or you'll stumble. Humble people ask questions. They realize that they don't know everything. They walk into a situation as learners, as curious, and they try to engage. Humble people learn. Humble people are patient people because people can be difficult. So humble people are patient. Jesus surrounded himself with 12 men who followed him and were knuckleheads at some times. But Jesus was kind and patient with them. Proverbs. For changing our thinking on who God is, we go to the book of Psalms. For understanding what humility looks like and how to live, we see this in Proverbs. Proverbs 11:2 says, "When pride comes, then comes disgrace, but with humility comes wisdom." Proverbs 12:1, "Whoever loves discipline loves knowledge, but whoever hates correction is stupid." So there's a need for humility. Do you know that children ask 125 probing questions a day? Adults, we ask about 6. So somewhere between childhood and adulthood, we lose about 119 questions on average. We stop becoming curious. We stop learning. We think we know it, and so we aren't curious anymore. So to become less, as John said, I must become less, and he must become greater. We have to humble ourselves. John understood that compared to Christ, who has infinite value, that he needed to bend his life in response to worship. So let me ask you, how humble are you when it comes to your understanding of who Jesus is? Have you positioned your life in a way to elevate him where he becomes greater and we become less? Going back to the sun and the moon, to what extent are we reflecting him? To what extent are we reflecting him? Finally, not only do we see in John kind of this upward thinking of who God is and this downward living of humility, but we see an outward impact. In Matthew 11, Jesus says this about John. He says, "Truly I tell you, among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." That's an interesting contrast. At first he says there's no one greater than John the Baptist, yet whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. So what's going on here? The greatness of John had to do with where John was in history. John cleared the way for Christ. He prepared the way. He was what's considered the last of the prophets prior to Christ. So John's opening as an offensive lineman, kind of clearing the way for Christ. So that's what made John great, was his greatness in history as the precursor to who Jesus was and making that known. So then the question is, who is the least in the kingdom of heaven? So in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come and they would rest on men and women to empower them for a job, to empower them for a task, and would give them supernatural power to be obedient to the task that God had given. in the New Covenant, in the New Testament, we see this idea of the Holy Spirit coming and invading believers and empowering them to do God's work, to speak when they don't know what to say, to do tasks that are too great for them. There's this spirit that we have, God's spirit, that enables us to do more than what we could do on our own. So those of us that have given our lives to Christ, we have that spirit. We have the spirit that enables us to do more than what we could do on our own. So John was the greatest because of where he was in history. But you and me, as believers in Jesus Christ, with the spirit that lives in us, we can experience his work and his power in a way that John couldn't. So that's pretty exciting. Those of us who come to Christ, we have that. So the idea of greatness in the kingdom is based on who Christ is in us, not on what we can do on our own. So Jesus gives us that power. He's the one who kind of directs that. So we have a decision to make as we kind of interact with this, and that is to orient our view of who God is, to submit to him, and orient our view of who he is according to Scripture, and the God that really exists in Scripture, and not the one that we kind of piece together from our own experiences. So when we submit to that, and we humble ourselves, and we realize that he must become greater, we must become less, that he begins to work in us. And that outward impact that we see isn't based on a position that we have. It's not based on you getting that next promotion or me getting that next opportunity. It's based on this servant-centered heart and attitude that we see all throughout Scripture. So we serve God. We are obedient to him where we are. We don't need a position. We don't need a platform to do that. Where God has given you, where God has put you right now, is where he wants you to use that, to submit to him, to realize who he is, and to orient your life around that. So, dog theology, I encourage us all to reorient our lives to who he is, not who we, what we think we want. So, let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your word. We are grateful for how you speak to us, for this message of John the Baptist, and just moving our lives to who he is, to who you are, and kind of reshaping what you want from us. Father, we are in need of you. We're in need of your spirit. We're in need of your direction. Father, help us to have an accurate view of who you are, to submit to what you want from us. Father, you are good. Help us to trust you. In Jesus' name.
Whole creation, you did not deserve. despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you
Awesome, awesome morning. I started off over at Arnold, saw a young high school girl get baptized, came over here led by a tremendous band, right? I mean, was that not great? That last song, The Bridge, and the Church of Christ is Born. Man, I get goosebumps every time, sorry. And then a great message by Tim. Give it up for Tim. This is kind of how my mind works. I love the analogies he gave when we put God, where he's supposed to be, that he's the King of Kings. When we submit to him, then we are to reflect him the way that the moon reflects the light of the sun. So I wrote in my notes, as a follower of Jesus Christ, I am to be about going out and mooning people. Right? So, sorry, Tim. So, all right. Just a couple of announcements then, real quick. We've got the men's, the men's barbecue tomorrow night, correct? Yeah. It's in your bulletin. So tomorrow night, invite some guys. They can invite guys, right? Yeah. Invite as many as they can. Come to that. Josh will be back next week. I know next Saturday there's a breakfast with dads over at the Arnold campus. Check your bulletin, all right? And then I'm going to just say a prayer, and then we'll close down. Father in heaven, you're good, and we are to praise you. We are to thank you. We are to acknowledge that you are over all, that you are the King of the universe, that we are to humbly serve you and to surrender and submit our lives to you. And when we do that, Father, when we give up ourself, we really find true life. We thank you for that. We thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit in us. I thank you for people that serve, that bring the word, that attend, and that are lights out in the world. Help us to go out and do that, Father. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. You guys have a good week.